Good evening, guys. Welcome to the 44th edition of the Boxing Gossip Podcast. Hope everyone's doing well. Had a lot of new subscribers jump on in the last week. So if you're new to the channel, we go live every Wednesday at 8:30. And we do a podcast which lasts about 2 hours discussing all the major boxing in the sport. So you're tuning into the right place if you're here live. I can see we've got a lot of the usual suspects in the chat already. So good evening, everyone. Thanks very much to everyone for spending their evening with us. Just quickly on this podcast, it's going to be slightly different to the usual routine because I'm actually away for work next week. So I'm not going to be able to do a podcast next week. And thankfully, that's a one-off because usually it's every single Wednesday. So because I can't do one next week, this week we're going to look ahead to some of the boxing, not only for this weekend, but for the weekend following as well. So we're going to be discussing Golovkin, Jacobs, and some of the other fights on this podcast, for example, which we wouldn't normally do. So a packed agenda tonight. Obviously, we're going to start with last week's boxing. We're going to be looking at Haye, Bellew, obviously, Garcia, Thurman, all of the other good stuff that went on last week. Then we'll move on to some of the news in the sport, obviously the return of Tyson, Fury, all of the other massive goings on that's going, that's been happening in the sport. And then we'll look ahead to the boxing for the next 2 weeks, given the fact that there's not going to be a podcast next week, as I say. So delighted to say, joined on the panel tonight by Jet, by Paul, by Irish Tom. So we've got a full squad going live. I'm going to start by bringing in Jet, actually. And Jet, there's only one place that we can really begin. Is Tony Bellew beating David Haye the biggest upset of your boxing lifetime?
Oh, you know, I don't know, because you guys always grilled me for the lighter weight classes, so I'm not actually sure. But yeah, definitely one of the biggest, you know. It's massive. David Haye was almost a 1 to 1,000, you know, 1 to 10,000 on by some of the people, not the bookies, but some of the people. They were giving Tony Bellew absolutely no chance. As we were speaking about, or just off air before he went on, I was watching with some of my mates, and they are total casuals, like absolutely. I said, look, Tony Bellew is catching David Haye in this first round, and this isn't David Haye of of old. This is a new downgraded Haymaker, and he looked lethargic, looked slow, and yeah, it was. Do you know what? From the first round, it wasn't a shock, but from before the fight, it was a shock. I put it that way. The first round kind of, it put it into perspective that Tony Bellew is very, very live in this fight. He's very, very much got a chance in this fight, and I think he grew confidence from the first round. Got a great win under his belt. He's right in the mix now.
I completely agree, Jet, that the first round set the tone for the rest of the fight, actually. When you were looking at that first round live, was your instinct, David Haye's got old overnight? David Haye 2.0 is a useless fighter? David Haye's carrying an injury? What was your perspective when you were watching it live?
Yeah, I mean, some people are saying the injury was evident before the fight. I wouldn't say that. You know, I did see the ring walk. I think in the ring walk, if you see the IFL footage, I'm not sure if you guys have seen it, but he wasn't walking as, briskly as normal. And David Haye normally has a very, a very savvy look when he comes to the ring, very, very much swaggered up. And, he comes with a nice sort of, bop in his step. And he didn't really look like that in the sort of walk to the ring. I mean, that's in hindsight, obviously. But on the night, I didn't see anything wrong up until, around round six when the injury happened, the Achilles injury. But definitely looked like he aged overnight. I mean, from the David Haye we know, he is a dynamite puncher. He is fast, elusive, athletic. And he was none of that against Tony Bellew. He made Tony Bellew look, I'll be honest. And that's not taking away anything from Tony Bellew, because I thought he was absolutely fantastic on the night, to be honest. And him and Dave Caldwell deserve a lot of respect for their game plan, the way they executed it, and, getting the win under the belt. But David Haye, he came out and he was throwing bombs from the first round. I don't know if he thought he was just going to chin Tony Bellew, or if he, you know, if that was his game plan from round one. But, you know, it's tough to say because he was trained out in Miami. He wasn't. He didn't really have a coach there. So maybe that does play a factor. You know, coaches are a big sort of theme in the sport. And I think they're, you know, they're severely underrated. And him not using Shane McGuigan in the corner properly over the course of a training camp probably cost him a lot more than he thought. But he's definitely aged. And he says he wants a rematch or a trilogy. Do you know what? I know we picked against Tony Bellew, against Makabu, picked against Tony Bellew. Some of us picked against him, against Mestanek. You know, I'm not picking against Tony Bellew. Let's put it that way. I think Tony Bellew does a number on him on the rematch as well. You know, there were some instances, even when Haye was fit and he was, you know, he was swinging wildly and he was missing very badly. And that's credit to Tony Bellew as well. But it shows, you know, the stage that David Haye's at in his career.
Definitely, definitely. And what's your take in terms of the future for both guys yet? Firstly, Tony Bellew's obviously got all these options in front of him now. The Haye rematch, the Wilder fight, the Parker fight, maybe even a Tyson Fury fight that's being called out, although I'm not sure how serious that is. But what do you think Bellew should do next? And do you think we will see a rematch, or do you think one of the two is going to have to call it a day?
Yeah, I mean, been kind of the Tony Bellew hype train, I guess, has been in full force after the win. Obviously, he called out Wilder. Was it after the fight? He called out Wilder that he's not going to fight AJ because he's a really good mate of his. Blah blah blah. So yeah, I mean, Wilder's a definite option, and Wilder's team have already said, you know, they're considering Tony Bellew. They're not going to rule him out. He's not the first choice, but they'll consider him. So that's on the cards. Parker's team actually came out today and said no problems going to Liverpool, going to London and fighting Tony Bellew over here. Fight as well, you know. It's not a pay-per-view fight. I know you made a video talking about Haye and Bellew and, you know, what's next for both the two. And some of the Kiwis seem to think that, you know, it's a massive pay-per-view event. I don't think so, but it's still a big fight. Tony Bellew, because of the hype he's got over beating David Haye. Who's the other one? You know, Tyson Fury, I know he's called him today. I don't really see that as a viable. You know, they're a bit, not pally, but, you know, they're a bit closer than, you know, a more, you know, the Parker and Wilder fights are more realistic than the Tyson Fury fight. But Dave Caldwell said he might retire. So it's up in the air with Tony Bellew. He's made a lot of money off this fight. And fair play to him, he deserves it. For me, probably the Parker fight. Parker is not a big heavyweight. Oh, sorry, I lie. He is a big heavyweight, but he's not the monster that Wilder is, 6'7", or Anthony Joshua, 6'6", and, 6'6", and built like a, you know, a massive steam train. So, you know, Parker's a realistic fight, and I think Parker's beatable. You know, I'm not saying Tony Bellew's going to beat him, but Parker's there for the taking, and Parker can be beaten. The fight has been officially made between Huey Fury and Joseph Parker. It was on Sky Sports News today, and I think it's May 6th in Auckland. So I'd expect Parker to actually lose that fight. I'm picking Parker to lose that fight. So it might be Huey Fury for all we know. But yeah, Tony Bellew's got options. David Haye, I think he needs to call it a day. You know, it's been publicized that he's in the game for money now. Whether that's true or not is another story. He said he wants to make an assault on the world heavyweight title. Whether or not he does, that's fine. Whether or not he wants to cash out fighting in someone like AJ or Wilder, that's for, you know, everyone else to decide. But he didn't look.
Surely those options are gone now, though, aren't they? I mean, those fights are gone.
Yeah, 100%. I think you know, you hit the nail on the head there. I totally agree with you. I think he really needs to, you know, look at what realistic options he has. You know, Tony Bellew is the guy he has to go through now. And what he said is right. He has to go through Tony Bellew to, you know, to get to the world champions. And yeah, I mean, that version of David Haye, you know, I think there's a good few heavyweights that you'd pick to beat him on that performance, because he just did not look like a, you know, a top elite heavyweight in there. I know he was winning up until the injury, but even up until the injury, he didn't look, you know, spectacular. So, you know, a credit to both fighters. You have to give a lot of respect to David Haye. He obviously didn't use the excuse because he's going to get a load of backlash, but you still have to give him a lot of respect. He hung in there, you know, with a bad injury. And Tony Bellew, obviously, he done what he needs to do. He got the W. He did struggle, even though David Haye was on one foot. So maybe people need to take that into consideration as well. But, you know, it was a decent fight. It wasn't a spectacular fight by any means. But, you know, it gave some value for money, I guess.
Absolutely. No, appreciate that, Jet. Paul, let's bring you in here. You're slightly longer in the tooth than Jet and I. In your experience of boxing, where does this rank in terms of the upsets?
Well, I'd have like Hasim Rakhman beating Lennox Lewis and Buster Douglas beating Tyson ahead of it, fights like that. But it was a big upset, you know. It was a big upset. We were just talking about this offline and before we went live. Like, I kind of like had it in my mind that it wasn't as cut and dry as we thought. I was thinking along the lines of kind of like how long Haye had been out for and his age and the injuries he's had and whatnot. You know what? I talked myself out of it. Last week on the podcast, I kind of said, oh, I got caught up in all the hype. He's going to do him in the first round and whatnot. And kind of like what I was thinking is kind of like what happened. I mean, Jet just said, like, I know David Haye was winning up until the injury or whatever. If I heard you right, I think that was what you said, Jack. Would you say David Haye was winning up until that point?
I would. I say he had a terrible first round and barely won the first round, but then I would say rounds 2 to 4 were clear Haye rounds. Even though he didn't look good, don't get me wrong. He didn't look good, but he looked good enough.
I mean, I'd say it was about even up until that point, to be honest. Haye was missing a lot for me. He was missing a lot. And when he was missing, Bellew was making him pay a little bit. You know, he was counter-punching quite well. That right, when Haye was trying the left hook, had, you know, Bellew had a bit of success with that. I thought it was about even up until that point. I thought Haye looked terrible. I just thought he looked terrible. He couldn't find his range. He didn't seem to be able to find his range. His jab seemed to just be non-existent. He was constantly short with it, and you know, he was missing wildly in a lot of, you know, I mean, I know the injury, you know, like the injury played a part, of course, but I was kind of like surprised that Tony Bellew was able to, I mean, he stayed with him. That was competitive. It was competitive up until the injury. I think it's, you know, it's hard to say it wasn't competitive. But it wasn't a classic.
Would you like a rematch, mate?
No, not really. I mean, this was, I believe I read it was the second heaviest Haye had ever come in.
That
combined with his age, combined with, he actually said, I don't know if anybody's seen the Sky Sports interview. After he'd had the surgery, there was a Sky Sports interview. I don't know if it was today or yesterday. I watched it today, and he said that actually that trip to the doctor in Germany was nothing to do with the Achilles. Oh, now it sounds like very, very odd that he goes to see a doctor that specializes in injuries and then his Achilles goes in the ring. But he insisted that that wasn't the case. I don't see what he would gain from lying about that. He actually said in that interview that he will divulge what that trip was about. So I think by that, you would have to assume that he's carrying some sort of other injury as well. But, you know, Bellew's not a heavyweight. Bellew for me just totally gassed. The extra weight that he was carrying was not good for him whatsoever. I think any of the heavyweight champions will absolutely spank him. I don't agree that he's got any chance against Stephen Parker. I think Parker is probably the weakest of the three champions, but I mean, I can't see him standing up to Wilder's power. Wilder's probably going to be a bit too tall for him as well. I just don't see him having any success against Wilder. Having said that, that's probably where he will go. Like one of the champions, it strikes me as he's kind of like doesn't want to stay in the game for too long. He was in the press conference after the fight. He was kind of like saying, "What are you going to do? Go and fight? Fight? I can't remember who it was." He said it might have been Lebedev or whatever, or Bradis or something. Or are you going to fight one of the heavyweight champions? He's kind of laughing it off, and it just strikes me as he's just going to cash out now. He's going to take a big fight and he's going to cash out. Obvious way to do it is AJ. I know he said he doesn't want to fight him because he's his mate and everything, but I mean, AJ is where the money is. It would be easy to make with them both being matchroom fighters. That's probably what, I mean, I wouldn't be at all surprised if that's what he does. I don't think it's what he should do, but I think it's probably what he will do.
Well, I agree with you completely on the weights, Paul. Thought Bellew looked fat and heavy, and I thought David Haye looked kind of muscle bound in there. Actually, he'd kind of lost the lightness on his feet. He looked a bit forced. I don't think that heavy weight, you know, 16 stone is necessarily good for David Haye. Actually, I think he's a slightly better fighter at a lighter weight. And yeah, I've got to admit, I do think there's going to be a rematch. So I think that's the biggest fight for both, and I think it's the most winnable fight for both guys as well. It really is. You know, if Bellew's going to lure one of the world champions over for a fight in the UK, they're going to want a big payday to come away from home, you know. But I think Bellew's probably going to be able to demand a 60-40 split with David Haye in a rematch. And, you know, I think that's going to be an even bigger fight first time round. And by all accounts, we don't know specific pay-per-view figures, but the numbers that Eddie Hearn was talking about on IFL TV, he was saying this was one of the most successful pay-per-view events in Britain ever. So whether we like it or not, you know, the casual market has spoken, and David Haye versus Tony Bellew is a massive, massive draw. Having said that, Haye does appear to be out for 6 to 9 months with this injury, Paul. So, I mean, do you not think the rematch, do you think Bellew will want to have a fight before the rematch? Is that your take on it?
I just think Bellew's looking to cash out, and I think he's looking to cash out sooner rather than later. Like you say, 6 to 9 months before, I mean, I assume that's 6 to 9 months before he can even start training again. Then you're looking at a training camp. So you're looking at probably a year's time at best before anything like that can happen. I mean, Haye looked old. And I don't know. I can see it not happening. I mean, I do agree with you. It's the best option for both, but I just think there's a couple of hurdles in the way. I think Bellew will take a fight. I mean, as Jet said, if Huey Fury beats Joseph Parker, which I think if Peter Fury's allowed to be there and the nerves don't get the better of Huey, and the judging's fair, of course, I think he probably will beat Parker. And judging from Parker's last couple of fights, I would, you know, Huey at his best, I think would just box the head off. I think he'd box rings around Parker, to be completely honest. But yeah, I mean, it's hard to know what what will happen next. I mean, I don't see Bellew just staying out for a year and waiting for the Haye rematch. I think he's going to want to probably do something and take advantage of the momentum he's got right now, because he has got momentum right now.
You're spot on. He's got big earning potential today, and he hasn't had that in his career.
And the thing is, that might not necessarily be the case in a year's time. In fact, undoubtedly, momentum always fades. And in a year's time, it certainly wouldn't be, he wouldn't have the momentum he's got now. I just think, some sort of fight, some sort of heavyweight fight, to try and maximise on that earning potential with that momentum that he's got at the minute would be probably the most likely scenario, to be honest.
Yeah. No, I hear you. Good points, Paul. Right, it's that time of the week. It's time to let Iris Tom out of his cage. Iris, let's bring you in. How are you doing?
Not too bad, lads. How's it going?
Yeah, not so bad, mate. Are you over your shock of the weekend?
Well, I was one of the lucky one on the panel not to be out boozing and not actually watching the fight. And I got some texts telling me what happened, and I didn't believe them until I watched it the next morning. So, yeah, what's there to say about that? Unbelievable.
Yeah.
I have a pizza in the oven, so I'll have to run away in a minute or two. But
Do you want me to go to one of the other guys and then come back to you, Tom?
No, give me a minute or two and then I'll go.
Okay, fair enough. So, what's your take on the best moves for both guys from here then?
Not so sure. That fight was just such a shit show of a fight, it must be said. It's just weird. It reminded me, there was a video doing the rounds there a few years ago of a chimpanzee in a zoo shagging a dead frog. I don't know if anybody has seen that video. It's like that fight was it's useless, but you're just drawn to it. It was a bizarre fight. I don't know. That must have been one of the worst pay-per-view cards in history, was it?
It was one of the most successful.
But that doesn't mean that it's any good.
I'm afraid
I really do have to run.
It's actually gone down, I think, from what I've heard. I agree with you that it wasn't a good fight, but it's actually gone down as a great fight, I think. That's the reception it seems to have received in the public.
Right, give me a minute. I have to cut this pizza up. It's coming out of the oven. I'm going to burn it. I'll be back in 3 minutes and I'll slate it a bit more. It's a potato and cabbage pizza.
Very nice, very nice. JG says, great analogy, Tom, by the way. Anyway, we'll let Tom go and we'll bring him back in. I'm going to go back to Jet, actually, because Jet's only with us for the first hour today, so I want to give him as much time as possible before he suits off. So, Jet, would you like to talk us through the undercard, mate, on the David Haye card and, you know, anything that stands out from you from that?
Yeah, obviously, Ahara Davis was on the card. He got a win, a decent win against Derry Matthews. But for me, that win's kind of flawed because Campbell done a number on Derry. So, you know, it doesn't really mean much. So, that's kind of my personal opinion on that fight. What was the other fights?
So you had Lee Selby. I didn't really think Lee Selby was looking that good, mate.
Yeah, I don't think he looked that good either, to be honest. You know, he's fighting a journeyman, Gago, was it? And
he
won me a bit of money, but nothing major. I mean, he should have stopped the guy, you know, 3-4 rounds earlier, to be honest. He should be stopping opponents like that, you know. I know he probably wanted to get the rounds under his belt, you know. He was out for a good while, but, you know, that's no excuse for you know, a guy of his level. He's really got to be stopping. He called Carl Frampton out after the fight, but, you know, that's a realistic fight because I think Barros is still the number one contender, but Carl Frampton's rated number two by the IBF. So it's a definite fight that can be made, you know, if the IBF enforce it. Obviously, Barros is having some sort of problems with Nevada State Athletic Commission if the fight is out in
America against. So, yeah. Sorry, the other ones. There's you know, there's so much.
Katie Taylor was on the card. Sam Eddington was beat Paulie Malignaggi. I'm just trying to think who else. Really, David Allen. David Allen in quite a bizarre fight, won by knockout.
Yeah, the Dave Allen one I was actually watching today, to be honest, and that was weird. His opponent was what, David Howe or something like that.
That's right. Yeah.
He looked even an even worse version of David Price. You know, he just folded at the first shot. Dave Allen actually threw the first decent shot. He just collapsed and he looked pretty poor. Dave Allen, you know, doesn't really learn anything from that. But I guess it's another W under his belt and onwards and upwards. I don't like how they're building him as a puncher. For me, Dave Allen's not a puncher, and I like Dave Allen. I know he's a friend of the channels, but you know he's not a puncher for me. He's more of a boxer, and you know maybe they're going to put him in with some. You know, some, I don't know, like journeyman or something like that, and they're going to think he's going to blow him out, you know, a durable one. And, you know, when he doesn't blow him out, you know, he might punch himself out or something. So, yeah, hopefully they match Dave Allen right. You know, I do think he can beat the winner of Sexton Cornish with a bit of time. He still needs a bit more experience for me. I actually picked Sam Eggington, so I got something right this weekend. Yeah, Sam, for me, he's not a splendid fighter or anything like that. He doesn't do anything spectacular. But for me, I just thought Paulie was a bit too old. You know, he was a bit run down. He had too many miles on the clock. And I proved to be correct. You know, Paulie in the fight, I mean, he was doing some smart things, but he didn't have the legs. You could kind of see his legs were not what they used to be, and a prime Paulie would have just moved around the ring, circled, and you know, kind of just jabbed Sam Eggington's head off. But this one, he tried to stay in the pocket, obviously, he said in the post-fight interview, and it just didn't work. You know, obviously the body shot crippled him, and yeah, he just didn't have the legs. So I'm glad he retired. You know, I didn't want to see him take any unnecessary punishment. You know, big thanks to Paulie. He's given some great memories to everyone, I guess. And yeah, he has a great job, I guess. You know, in Showtime and Sky, so he's going to be making some good money. I hope the same happens for Derry actually as well, who announced his retirement on Twitter as well and after the fight. Katie Taylor looked good. You know, she did miss a few punches, maybe just eager to impress, but she did look good. And I think you probably hit the nail on the head and, you know, said it very succinctly in your sort of analysis of the undercard, that, you know, we don't know what level she's at because we don't watch women's boxing. And that's not a bad thing. It's just we're not clued up and we don't want to give a false opinion of the fight. So of the fighter. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's got any strength in depth women's boxing, you see. I don't know. I look at Ahara Davies and I think he's above British level. He's probably European level. He's probably below world level. And I just don't have the same concept of that in women's boxing because I don't know the strength and depth is what I'm getting at, I guess.
Yeah, no, I agree because I'll be honest, I don't watch women's boxing. Not that it's a gender issue or anything like that. It's just it's not televised enough and whatnot. So we're not clued up, I guess. But for me, she's got the skills to be a world champion. You can just see it in her. I guess when she steps in the ring, you know, she looks vicious. I tell you that. I said it when I was with my mates. I said, you know, Katie Taylor could probably beat all of us up, to be honest. So, and then they all laughed and then they're like, yeah, she probably could. And I was just like, mate, her skills are amazing. So I wouldn't be surprised to see her win a version of the world title. And yeah, I mean. And yeah, Davis, I'm not really. Do you know what? I know you're keen on him, but I'm not that high on him. I'll be honest. I think he's a decent puncher at a certain level. He's got decent skills, but I don't know. He for me, he's not inspiring. I don't know. I know he talks all this rubbish. He's had this beef with Floyd Mayweather and that sort of stuff. But for me, he's just uninspiring. I don't rate him that high. I think Josh Taylor would do an absolute number on him. I'll be honest. Josh Taylor would I wouldn't say that, but you know, he would beat him from pillar to post, to be honest. And Ahara's footwork is very clumsy. It seems very, very clumsy to me. You know, he
he comes forward and it's not plodding, but it's just his feet are a bit all over the place. I don't know if that's just me, but yeah, he's a decent fighter, but at a certain level again.
Cool. Okay. Cheers, Jet. Let me go back to Irish Tom. Irish, you okay to speak, mate?
I am indeed, Jet. Sorry about that, lads.
No worries at all. So before we crack on, Tom, was there more you wanted to get off your chest on the Haye Bellew main event and their futures and retirements and rematches and that sort of stuff?
Yeah. Like watching that fight, it was clear that David Haye either was carrying an injury and was a bit shot and was slow from the start. But like, you know, put this, how bad this main event was into perspective. Tony Bellew had a guy who was shot and had one of his legs pulled off, and he still couldn't stop him. David Haye actually won rounds after his leg fell off.
That is true. Like, I actually tweeted after about 9 or 10 rounds, could David Haye win this on points? Because I thought that was looking a possibility.
Yeah, it's so retarded. Like, and Tony Bellew was gassed. Like, he had a man in front of him who couldn't walk, and Bellew was the one walking away from him because he was gassed. Just, like, you know, it's like putting two blind people with giving them both hammers into a ring and just letting them swing away for a while and see what'll happen. You know, I don't know, just, I'm so glad I didn't waste my evening watching that. But I know it was certainly kind of exciting in a certain sense, but like, I don't know, boys. I don't know. All this talk about all these guys calling out Tony Bellew. Like, you know, David Haye on that showing, say the first 5 or 6 rounds, probably was about a top 20 heavyweight. Nothing more, you know? Like, if you put David Haye in there with, you know, I don't think David Haye like that is not top 10. No, not nowhere close. Imagine what Huey Fury would have done to David Haye. You know, so I just think, where do they go from here? I don't know. It's a big money. Maybe Tony Bellew will get to take the rematch. Like, if he goes and fights any, like, you know, but look, I'm not one of these people who hates Tony Bellew, never has been. I kind of like him. I think he plays the game well. He slags guys and all that, and he talks shit and he builds up a fight. And he's done amazingly well for his capabilities. He's an overachiever. But at heavyweight, you know, I think Dominic Brazil would beat him up.
Wow. Do you think that there's any suggestion that Tony Bellew could drop down and defend his cruiserweight title? Or do you think that he's going to definitely stick at heavyweight due to the commercials?
I think Tony Bellew will take probably one big payday next, and then he'll retire. Whatever that payday is, I probably don't think it'll be David Haye, because he'd have to wait around too long and he mightn't come through. So I wouldn't be surprised if he goes, fights one of the heavyweight champions, gives him a voluntary, because he'd probably get David Haye's rankings. But David Haye lost his ranking in WBC because he gave up his VADA, as far as I'm aware. So whether Tony Bellew will be able to be a voluntary there, or will he get his, they'll probably just put him in, it's the fucking WBC, isn't it? But, you know.
Tom, sorry.
Yeah?
They'll probably put him in because he's WBC Cruiserweight Champion. So they'll probably just, you know,
yeah,
say he can go in the rankings as sort of like a contender or whatever, and he's beating a big contender, so they probably will, yeah.
Well, if they can put Warwick or Ariola Nipples himself in there, they can definitely put Bellew in. So yeah, I think Haye probably will retire. It's hard to see anybody giving them another shot, because you know he's got that style where it's so explosive, that style, and it just breaks down your body. It seems, especially if you're putting lots and lots of extra, like, Haye's not a natural heavyweight, I don't think. He probably beefed himself up for years to make, you know, himself a really muscular cruiserweight, you know. So, you know, his ankles and, you know, joints, shoulders and that probably aren't able to take the stresses that he's putting in. So I think, you know, he's a shot fighter, as in at the top level. Like, I lost money on that. You know, it's one thing. That's the one thing about coming on and doing YouTube and podcasts and stuff like that. You kind of have to, like, say what you think. And every so often, a result comes along like this, and you feel like a total stooge. Like, I felt like, you know, I'm glad I wasn't on Twitter that night. All the fucking, was a crow I'd have to eat.
I don't think you're the only one this time around, Tom. I think this is one where 95% of people got it wrong. And to be fair, every man and his dog has popped up in my comment section claiming to have picked Tony Bellew. But beforehand, we were very much in the majority. What about Sam Eggington and Ahura Davies? What upside do you see those guys having? Could either of them be a world champion?
I like Sam Eggington. He's made a convert to me. I think he'll give a lot of guys. It's still 140. Is he going to 147? He's 147. He's always 147. Yeah. He's a big 147. How big did he look compared to Paulie Malignaggi?
Oh, he's a monster. Massive. Yeah, he's a monster. Yeah.
Yeah, so I think he'll give a lot of guys, like, I don't think he'll ever win a title, but he'll give a lot of guys a lot of grief. You know, he'll give top guys a good hard eight rounds. You can imagine, like, him having a entertaining scrap with Errol Spence and then getting KO'd or something. But I thought that was a really poor, was that the chief support? Because I didn't actually watch them in order. Was that the number two fight?
That was the chief support.
Katie Taylor was the chief support, actually, to be honest.
No, Katie Taylor was a float, and Katie Taylor got put on before the main event as the float. The chief support was Malignaggi Eggington.
Wasn't it Davis versus Matthews? I don't know. I heard conflicting reports, but yeah.
David Matthews was, but then it got demoted after.
After they listened to us slagging it as the chief support gossip.
That's right. Yeah. Mauricio Sullivan called me up, and what about Ahura Davies?
I like Ahura Davies. I think he's got a lot of talent. I think that it wasn't a great fight, though. But it's the kind of fight he should be having. You know, it's one of those things where I don't think it should be like chief support or second support, like for a big pay per view like that. I think it should be on way down the schedule, or it should be on a normal Saturday night fight, you know. But I think Ahura Davies has got something. I think he's good. But Derry was fighting. Derry is shot, and he's fighting at a weight class he never fought again. He looked weak. So it's just one of those fights that an up and rising guy should be taking. And he's a work in progress, but I think he's got lots of talent, you know. And I think he didn't have much amateur experience. So I am fully up with developing guys slowly and at the right pace. So I think that's a good performance, a fine fight for him to have at this stage of his career. But, you know, I don't think it deserves to be, like, so high up in the billing on a big fight like that.
Okay. And finally, did you have a look at Lee Selby, Tom?
No, I didn't. I have no interest in going looking at that. What happened?
He went into sparring partner mode and really never got out of first gear and laboured against a dwarf who was incapable of defending himself.
An actual dwarf or just a small guy?
I don't know. It was we might even have to do a poll of opinion on whether this guy was very, very small. Let's put it that way.
Apparently, there is a technical difference between being a dwarf and being a midget, that a midget is classified as being, say, small for your... just quite not very tall, but proportionate, and being a dwarf is someone suffers from dwarfism. I thought I'd just throw that in there for you.
Well, you learn something every night when Iris Thomas is on. If it's not a what animal was it that were making love earlier, Tom?
Sorry, what?
What pair of animals was it you were talking about making love?
A chimpanzee and a frog. Well, and I don't think
this is the dwarf. Yeah,
I don't think making love is the right verb there.
Yeah,
I think he got the dwarfism thing from that film in Bruges with Colin Farrell and Brendan Gleeson. They talk about that in a midget is proportionate, has normal sized arms and legs and stuff.
Yeah, but no, Paul, they got it from me.
Oh, was it?
Yeah, right, yeah, okay. Yeah. Let's get this right.
Sorry.
Well, yeah. Regardless, always learn something on this, so I'll tell you. I'm going to go back to Paul in a minute. We've got 175 people watching live, so shout out to everyone who's joined us. If you're one of those, please hit the thumbs up button, support the site. Let me go back to Paul. Sam Eggington, Paul, you're a big Sam Eggington fan. I've got to give you credit. You've picked Sam several times on this channel and got it right. As you guys know, I thought Malignaggi was going to get the job done. So give us your take on Sam Eggington's fight.
Yeah, well, you know, I've got to agree with Jet. I mean, Paulie looked bad, and I thought it was a bad game plan from Paulie. Kind of like, I mean, what I don't know why he was trying to stay in the pocket against a bigger guy. I just think Paulie's shot. Did Paulie retire after this?
He did.
Yeah, I thought so. Yeah, I mean, it was a decent win. I mean, I wouldn't say I'm a huge Sam Eggington fan. You know, but he's certainly done all right for me with the old picks. I've done quite well with him. So yeah, I tell you what, I'll never be fucking picking against Bellew again. Every single time I pick against him, he wins. Like, it's ridiculous. But yeah, it was an all right fight. It was an all right fight. What was the other fight? So Harrod Davies looked pretty good. But I mean, I think Derry was just totally shot, wasn't he? I mean, he didn't look good against Scarpa. I'm not so sure about Harrod Davies. I don't think he's world level. He's got talent. He's maybe got a bit of potential to maybe get there, but I don't think he is at the minute. He didn't look good in the Scarpa fight for me. And who else was it?
Dave Allen, Katie Taylor, Lee Selby.
Yeah, I only seen a little bit of the Lee Selby fight. I didn't see it all. I've had a bit of a busy week, and I didn't see either of you the two yet. Sorry. So
no worries. Did you see Thurman Garcia by any chance?
Yeah, I saw that, yeah.
Let's move on to that one. So I watched that fight, and I watched it on Sunday morning, but I didn't check any social media. So I watched it not knowing the result at the time, and I thought Keith Thurman won it clearly. I was amazed after the fight, not only that it was a split decision, but there actually seemed to be a genuine sentiment that Danny Garcia got robbed. And you know, I was listening to the Boxing Voice the other day, and lots of people out there were saying it was a robbery. So, yeah, give us your take on that, Paul. How did you see that fight? Who do you think won? How did you score it, etc.?
No, I had it 116-112 to Thurman. I thought he won the fight. I do not see a way in which you can possibly say Garcia won. He just became very low output until towards the end of the fight. I mean, I think he couldn't deal with Thurman's movement. I didn't think he could deal with Thurman's movement at all. Thurman landed much the cleaner work. It wasn't a great fight, you know. It wasn't like a Thurman Porter, was it? You know, I don't know. Garcia looked very low volume for me. I don't think he did anywhere near enough to be even close to a draw, let alone, you know, winning on one of the cards. I've got absolutely no idea how that happened. I thought he won by miles.
Yeah, I agree, and I also felt the rounds that Garcia did win, a lot of them were rounds that Thurman kind of let him win, didn't he? Like, at the end, Thurman just kind of decided to stay out of range for the last couple of rounds. Like, I'm not 100% sure that Garcia was really winning anything major in the fight. How good do you think Thurman is, Paul? Do you see Thurman potentially being the number one welterweight when the dust settles and everyone fights everyone?
No. I think if Cal Brook stays at 147, it's going to be either Brook or Spence that will be number one, to be completely honest. Thurman's all right. I'm not a huge fan of him. He's kind of like... he's okay, but I think Brook is... Brook at his best, I think, is a lot better than Thurman, in my opinion. I think Errol Spence is going to emerge on top of the pile at 147, to be honest. I think really kind of like Thurman has sort of like come to prominence in an era where the welterweight division is in a bit of a sort of transition period. A lot of the top guys are either retired or they're just not what they were and stuff. And I think he's kind of like emerging round the top of the pile now, really due to a lack of other people to emerge there, you know. I think Errol Spence will be the one that will come out on top in the long run. Like,
yeah, no, I can completely hear what you're saying. Definitely. What do you think Danny Garcia will do next after this one, Paul?
I don't know. I've never really been sold on Danny Garcia at 147. I think he's a 140 fighter. I don't think he's... I've never been sold on him at 147. He probably won't move down, but that's what I think he should do. What will he do? He's not a champion anymore, so... I don't know. Might try and get the Thurman rematch, but whether that'll happen or not, I don't know. I know Angel Garcia was like, surprise, surprise, whinging, like, you can't run. He was saying that, like, what Thurman was doing was running and that, you can't run, this is boxing, blah, blah, blah. He's, like, clearly wounded that his son lost the fight. I mean, I understand that, but, I mean, his son lost the fight quite clearly. That's the problem.
Yeah, I agree. There's Sean Porter's fighting Andre Berto, so potentially the winner of that would be a good comeback fight for Garcia, I guess. But, let's go over to Jet. Jet, presuming you watch Garcia Thurman, if so, give us your take, how you scored it, and where you see both guys.
Yeah, I didn't actually watch it, so I wouldn't have an opinion on the fight. I know, obviously, the furor's kind of come out for the fight, but from who I've spoken to, They seem to be picking Thurman quite comfortably. So I'm not sure where this kind of stuff with Garcia has come out. But it's a very, very select few, it seems. Obviously on the boxing voice, but someone like yourself, I actually respect quite highly his opinion. So, yeah, from what I'm hearing, Thurman, but obviously I don't know. I haven't scored it, so I'd have to watch the fight and score it accordingly.
Makes sense. And now Thurman's won the fight. Would you like to see him in against a Brook Spence winner? Do you think that's the most natural matchup for him?
Yeah, I mean, Thurman's kind of showed that he's willing to fight the top guys at 147. So for me, it's a logical next step for Keith Thurman. But whether or not it will happen is sort of another question, I guess. That's the main thing, because Brooks over here with Matchroom, if Errol Spence wins, it's kind of an easy fight to make because they're both out in America, both our Haye fighters, so it shouldn't be too bad for Spence if he wins. But, you know, for number one welterweight, you know, he's up there, but in terms of just talent then who would be the top? It'd probably be the Brooks Spence winner. Manny Pacquiao will probably be number one now just due to resume, and, you know, he's still beaten guys of note like Tim Bradley at a good level. So yeah, that's kind of my thoughts on that. Also, the Berto Porter fight you were talking about, Tom, is a final eliminator for the WBC version. So the winner will be mandatory for that. They said Khan actually lost his mandatory position after moving up to thing. Well, that's what reports said. So yeah.
Cool. Yeah, no, that makes sense. Jet, are you leaving us in 5 minutes or so?
Well, I'm not actually at my destination yet, so I'll be on for, you know, a fair amount. So you can go to someone else if you want, and then come back to me if you want.
Cool. All right. Absolutely. I'll bring an Irish Tom in that case. Cheers, Jet. Iris, did you watch?
No.
Did you watch Thurman Garcia?
I did. I watched it today.
Okay, give us your take on that matchup, mate.
I thought that was, like yours all are saying, a very clear for Thurman. Thurman's, like Danny Garcia, I don't agree with Paul saying he's not a 140 fighter. I think he is a 140 fighter. He's just not elite. And he probably did well at 147 fighter. I think at 140, you know, he did pretty well too. So I think he showed quite good defensive work there, but he's not a stalker. You know, he's a counterpuncher, and you know, he couldn't react to the athleticism that and conservative fighting that Thurman implemented. Like, I don't know if you guys watched the American feed. It was Sugar Ray Leonard was on it, and Sugar Ray Leonard was talking quite a bit towards the end of the fight about Thurman, you know, how he needs to punch in combination, and you know, he really doesn't do it. Like, he's a very athletic guy, and I think he's quite analytical. I think he's a smart guy, but you know, he's not a combination puncher, and he's not very fluid looking. Like, he might hit hard and stuff like that, but he doesn't look smooth like Floyd or like say Sugar Ray Leonard. He's quite I don't know. I don't know what it is about his style. He's just quite athletic. I think, you know, the power. I think Danny showed a very good chin. I think he got caught quite a few times. But you know, I think if Errol Spence is able to beat Cal Brook, I think he'll beat him as well.
Sorry, mate. I had myself on mute there for a second. Okay. So in terms of the welterweight division, do you kind of see that as the top fight out there at present, the winner of Brook Spence versus Keith Thurman at this stage?
Yeah, and Manny Pacquiao as well. Any of those four potential people are the number one. Like, for me, Manny is number one still. But yeah. Until he loses it or he retires, I think Manny's number one, or he starts looking really shit. And he hasn't looked poor. He's had some good wins. So for me, you know, I think Manny beating Tim Bradley is just as probably a better result than beating Danny Garcia. So, you know, I don't think there's too much between them. Honestly, I'd probably pick Manny Pacquiao ahead of Thurman. I just think he'd have too many tricks and too much unorthodox stuff for Thurman. You know, but Manny might be aging. But yeah, so I think the welterweight division is a little bit overrated, to be honest with you. Like, I think that Thurman is good, but, you know, compared to the 154 division, you know, there's lots of good guys there too. It's just, I suppose, just people are thinking that it's super deep, like, because it used to have, you know, Cotto and Floyd and Manny and these people, but I don't think it has that same class of fighter now or anywhere close.
Yeah, no, I hear you. I think a lot of the luster from the division has kind of departed with the retirement of Floyd Mayweather, definitely. And I think Manny Pacquiao, even though he is the number one, you know, he's kind of viewed as a guy on his way out, as is Tim Bradley. And, you know, guys like Amir Khan and Kell Brook, who are big-name fighters, have taken big losses. Did you happen to see Dawson Funfora on the undercard, Iris?
I tried to catch it, but it was in like some Polish commentary version where the heads of the fighters was clipped out. You can only see them up to the neck. So I was like, I tried to watch for a round or two, and I was just
screwed out. I didn't see that, so I just thought I'd check to see if you did.
Was there another undercard fight? What was the other one?
It was Erickson Lubin, but I didn't watch that.
Yes. Oh, it's well worth. You should watch that.
Oh, he was very good, was he?
Yeah, and it's only like three rounds, and it's actually a really good fight. Lublin, I think is it Lubin or Lublin?
Lubin.
Lublin is a place in Poland. I was mixing that up. But the another fact from Irish. It's two tonight, lads. City in eastern Poland. But I think that's the second time I saw him. The first time I think I saw him, I didn't think that much about him, but this time I thought he was really impressive. He scored probably the knockout of the year. I know there's been a lot of good knockouts so far. He did this really crazy thing where he kind of did, like, you know, what do you call those Russian dancers when they get down on their heels? What do you call those guys?
I'm afraid my Russian dancing knowledge is limited, Tom.
Cossack.
What? Cossack. Good man, Paul. Yeah, the Cossack dancing. But the boys get down and their hunkers and start kicking their legs out in front. He went down straight to his hunkers for no reason. Like, he was standing in front of the guy, jumped down to his hunkers. It's really bizarre. Then jumped up and then hit him with the lead right hand and knocked him clean out. I mean, he knocked him out. The guy wasn't unconscious, but he was as good as, man, it was a really, really, it was like a Roy Jones type one. You know, the one where Roy Jones puts him behind his back.
Yeah.
Like, it was kind of similar to like that. It was very odd. I don't know what the fuck he was thinking. It was really bizarre. But Lubin is a serious talent. Like, say, compare Lubin, say, to Thurman. Lubin is very fluid. Thurman, there's something robotic about, I don't even know if it's robotic. I don't know. There's something just, I don't know. It's like Keith is like an athlete that he'd be good at lots of different sports, but he doesn't have that real fluid skill that a Floyd or Sugar Ray or, you know, any of these top fighters have. But I'd recommend watching that. It was well worth. He's going to be a star.
Yeah, he seems very, very well regarded. Tom, one more with you. I've got to ask you about the Tyson Fury tweets, mate. What's your take on the potential comeback of Mr. Fury?
Well, you know, he's fighting under the best boxing board in the world, the BUI, the Boxing Union of Ireland.
He's not.
Since when?
They've come out and said that their statement is incorrect. He doesn't have an Irish license, and he's never applied for an Irish license. And if he did apply for an Irish license, he wouldn't get one because he's banned by another body. He's suspended by another body.
Well, that's good to hear. So who knows? Like, I hope he's back in training. I know there's been a picture floating around of him looking like a beached whale, but in a kebab shop. But I don't know if that's a current picture or not. But I think I saw a photo from like 4 weeks ago. I don't know where, that he was actually looking reasonably trim. You know, as in he shifted some weight. I hope he comes back, but I just, you know, I'm not going to give it too much thought until he actually has a fight signed and we see him in shape.
Yeah, Alexander Ustinov has called him out after their fight was cancelled previously. So Alexander Ustinov wants to be the comeback opponent. Do you think that's the right sort of level if he were to come back?
Yeah, perfect level. I hope Tyson comes back. I really do. Like, a lot of, we're all fans of Tyson. But Tyson is just, you know, he just creates a lot of buzz and a lot of shit talk and, you know, all that stuff that gets people interested in the sport. So I hope he comes back. And I hope this old bullshit surrounding himself and Huey, it gets cleared up one way or the other. Either they get banned or they don't get banned, you know. It's just like it's just like a pain in the ass as a fan having all this stuff hanging around.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree. Okay, cheers, Iris. Paul, what's your take on the news relating to Tyson?
Well, the hearing's in early May, isn't it? The hearing for
It is, but it keeps getting moved and moved and moved. So do we really have any confidence that it's going to happen at any time?
Yeah, well, this is supposed to be kind of like fixed date now. So I don't know. Yeah, I mean, like you say, it might get moved. Who knows?
Lads, Paul, do you reckon? I reckon it's Peter Fury is using his fucking money to get the lawyers on the case and just string it out, where any ban will be in the past. What do people reckon?
I think there's some fun and games going on. I'm not 100% sure why, but I do think time is a healer with these things. So I guess if they can delay it, wouldn't surprise me.
But are we sure that that's how it works? So, like, that ban runs from when it actually was imposed? Because, I mean, I'm not sure that's the way it works.
I'm not 100% sure. I know it has happened like that in the past, but I can't say that I'm sure that would be the case for a new ban, no.
But if that's the case, lads, like, how can they do the test in fucking 2015 and not say Anton for a year or whatever was?
It might be because,
like,
retirement. That might be why he announced his retirement right.
No, but the test though, but the test was from 2015. We're talking about Huey's ones as well. Like, if their test was when he fought Hammer in 2015 or whatever the hell it was. Like, how come it took a year for that thing to come out? They can't just sit on a test for a year and then fucking go over. That's
weird. Very fucking weird.
Really, really weird. So, like, either somebody, whoever is reporting it, or the, you know, like, well, that's supposed to be coming from, like, that was the Daily Mirror, the original one from UCAD was saying that it was from ages ago. Like, maybe the Furies were all the time trying to put that one off and just fighting in the meantime. Because that seems to be what's happening still. Just keep your lawyer on it and try and keep it going for 3 years, and then the whole thing will fall apart.
Yeah, yeah. I just want to say as well, Erickson Lubin. I mean, I've been saying about Erickson Lubin for a while. The kid is seriously talented. He did look really, really good the weekend. Just wanted to sort of like echo what Tom said on that. Erickson Lubin's one to watch. Definitely one to watch.
Did you see his knockout, Paul? Did you see what I'm talking about, that Cossack shit?
Yeah. I don't know what he was doing, but the knockout was phenomenal, man. I just think he's really, really talented. He does it's not just that. He does other very unorthodox things. Like, he bounces off the rope and hits people as well. I don't know if you've seen many of his other fights as well, but he does a lot of really unorthodox things, but he's really, really talented, man. Talented kid.
Definitely. Now, he's light middleweight, right?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
Okay. It's kind of one of them awkward divisions where the water's quite deep, but the names aren't the biggest names. So it'd be interesting to see how they manage him and how they bring him on, I guess. But yeah, I need to check him out because I've heard really, really good things. Definitely. Okay. So, Paul, all in all, are you optimistic, or are you sort of losing faith in this Tyson Fury comeback then?
Well, I mean, I was trying to look for some pictures the other day, and like Iris said just then, a lot of the pictures you find, it's like, when were they actually fucking taken? Like, you know, I found a few photos of him looking absolutely awful. But then I've seen a few of him looking better as well. So it just, I don't know. I don't know whether he's going to, I mean, I personally think it depends on what happens with this UCAD thing. I think we are likely to see him back. I don't think it will be in May, though.
Yeah, May feels a bit ambitious, doesn't it? Frank Warren was very distanced when he was asked about that as well. Like, if Frank thought that was realistic, he'd be trying to promote the hell out of it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Frank just went, well, yeah, the hearing's in early. If he passes the hearing, he'll fight. If he doesn't, he won't. I think he brushed it off very, very quickly. And yeah, like you say, if Frank thought he was going to fight in May, he'd be trumpeting that from the rooftops, because, you know, Tyson's one of his, I know he's a Mick Hennessy fighter, but, you know, Frank Warren's involved, and he with Box Nation and everything. And he's definitely, I mean, he's the biggest name that Frank has anything to do with.
Without doubt. Yeah. By quite some margin as well.
Yeah.
Perfect. I'm just going to go to Jet, Paul, because I think he's just going to suit off.
Yes, mate.
So I'll go to Jet, and then I'll come back to you in just a second. But Jet, are you there, mate?
Hello.
Hello, Jet. Let me. I know you got a suit off, mate. I didn't read your message, but I saw the first line. So let me come to you just quickly. Firstly, for your take on the Tyson Fury news, and then we'll get your picks for the 2 weeks boxing ahead.
Yeah, I mean, Tyson Fury, I was actually buzzing that he put out that tweet and said he wanted to come back. But obviously, it's kind of fallen on deaf ears, I guess. I mean, loads of people want him back, but they haven't, as you said, they haven't really promoted it. And yeah, hopefully he'll come back. I'm sure he will. But I think, as you said, as you guys said, May's a bit ambitious, a bit unrealistic. You know, give maybe a few more months, maybe July, August, sometime might be realistic. But it'll be interesting to see if who he fights on his comeback. Will he go straight in deep waters, or will he kind of just bang up a journeyman or something like that? So it'll be interesting to see what he does.
Ustinov seems to be the rumoured name at the minute, mate. What do you make of Ustinov as an opponent?
Yeah, Ustinov was supposed to fight Fury.
You there, Jack?
And Tyson Fury pulled out. It's an okay opponent. That's not terrible. I'd much rather prefer him, you know, fight, Ustinov, than, you know, someone like a, I don't know, Alex Leopold or someone like that, you know, someone who's, he's semi-decent, I guess. So, yeah, it wouldn't be a bad opponent.
Cool. Okay. Let's look ahead, Jack, because I know you got to shoot off to the boxing coming up. There's, you know, as I said earlier on the show to everyone watching live, I'm not going to do a podcast next week, because unfortunately I've got a working commitment. So we're doing picks this week for both this week's boxing and next week's boxing. So yeah, just looking ahead, Triple G versus Danny Jacobs, probably the biggest fight. Dennis Kalin versus Isaac Lowe, Amir Mansour versus Travis Kaufman, Gary Russell Jr., Jamie Conlon this week, Lemieux versus Stevens. What's your picks on some of the big fights, mate? And which ones are you looking out for the most?
Yeah. Golovkin to win against Jacobs. I'm not really looking forward to the fight, but you know, if it's a decent scrap, it wouldn't go amiss. Isaac Lowe versus Dennis Kalin or Salen. That's not a bad fight, actually. You know, two guys, probably European level guys. You know, Isaac Lowe maybe a bit above British, and Salen obviously beat Ryan Walsh last time out, so a very, very good win for him. You know, that's a very tough fight. I don't know. I've seen Isaac Lowe. He looks very good, but obviously Salen's obviously beat a half-decent opponent in Ryan Walsh. So that's a 50-50. I'd probably side with Dennis Salen in that fight. Who's the other one? Amir Mansour versus Kaufman. The betting odds are quite close for this fight, or they were when I saw them. It was, it was a relatively tight fight with the bookies. I was going to put a bet on Mansour. I think he was slight outsider. But, I'd probably go with Mansour in that fight. I think, you know, Kaufman's there to be hit. He's there to be hurt. He got hurt by Areola. So, Kaufman probably be a... Mansour would be a good option in that for a bet this weekend. Stevens versus Lemieux, that's another very good fight. I put my someone tweeted me, I can't remember who it was, and asked me my opinion. I'd probably side with Stevens for that fight. I think he's slightly more durable. You know, they're both big punchers, but Stevens, you know, obviously went the distance with Golovkin, but he went in, you know, with him trading. David Lemieux was just getting systematically beat up with the jab. So
Stevens didn't go the distance with Golovkin.
Huh?
Stevens didn't go the distance with Golovkin.
No, sorry, eight rounds. He went eight rounds. Sorry, the same distance. My apologies. But okay. Yeah, I mean, it's a that's probably the best fight of the weekend, to be honest. You know, that is that's a really good fight, and yeah, I'm looking forward to that. Probably just pick Stevens in that fight.
Okay. No, that makes sense, Jeff. I'm just having a look to see if there's any other ones. Is Demetrius Andrade fighting this weekend, Jack?
Yeah, against Jack Cossé.
Yeah, have you seen Mark
Cossé? Cossé is a sort of fringe world level opponent. You know, the guys who pick the Saulin guys. I know he's not with Saulin, but or he might be, I'm not sure. Yeah, he is actually. But you know, those guys who pick up those interim belts and then they get the regular belt. So Tyrone Zoiga, those sort of guys. Yeah. He's at that level, you know. He's not good enough to compete with the elite of the division. Underneath that, you know, under the world-class guys, he's there or thereabouts. He can deal with, like, maybe the Liam Smiths or those sort of guys he'd be a good opponent for.
Andrade should, you know, if he's up to anything, I know he's been really inactive, but if he's up to anything, he should be stopping this guy, I'll be honest. You know, this guy, I don't even know if he'd do that well against someone like Willie Nelson or something like that. So, or who was the other guy? Tony Harrison or someone like that. So, he's good, but yeah, I don't really expect him to pose too many problems to Andrade.
Fair enough. Cool. Jet, was there anything else you wanted to get off your chest or any other topics you felt an urge to discuss before you take your departure, mate?
There was one thing, but it just doesn't come to my head at this moment in time. Hopefully it's a good week or two of boxing, whilst we don't have this podcast next Wednesday, so you won't get to hear my burning thoughts on all the fights and all the upcoming fights. So yeah, nothing else from me.
Fantastic. Well, Jet, have a good evening, and I'll catch up with you in 2 weeks online and perhaps before then offline.
Yeah, sure, mate. Sorry to everyone. I have to leave. I have to just have a meeting to attend to. So, yeah, take care, guys, and I'll speak to you guys soon.
Cheers, Jet. Thanks a lot, mate.
The woman. Yeah, mate.
Say hello to the woman for us, Jet.
Yeah, just for you, Irish Tom, I'm going to show you a picture. I'm going to show her a picture of you, mate.
There you go.
Oh, the lucky one.
Take care, boys. Cheers.
Thanks, Jet. Cheers. See you. So I wanted to go to Jet and just talk about some of the upcoming boxing before he departed, so he had a chance to make his picks. But we'll stick with the news section with Paul and Tom, and then we'll go back to that. And one big bit of news that I wanted to come to is, it's two separate bits of news that I think entwine nicely into one. Eddie Hearn loses the purse bid for Callum Smith versus Anthony Durrell, a fight that he was actually proposing to hold at Anfield, and they're now going over to the States. So the purse bid was won with a $1.6 million bid, whereas I believe Eddie Hearn bid $1.2 million. The same week, Frank Warren has done a deal to bring Gervonta Davis over to the UK to fight versus Liam Smith. For me, a fight that I'm actually fairly looking forward to. So Callum Smith is having to get some extra stamps on his passport. Liam Waltz is getting home advantage. So we're going to start with our resident Eddie Hearn hater, Irish Tom. Tom, give us your take on these two fights, mate.
Well, I'm just surprised, Gossip, that you haven't done a whole load of videos yet saying, what's wrong with Eddie Hearn? He, you know, things are going bad for him. He didn't win this thing, you know, blah, blah, blah. You know, Eddie Hearn got by Al Haymon, but, you know, that's probably likely to happen. The Callum Smith versus Durrell fight, it's not a fight I'm very up for, to be honest. Are you going to do videos on that, Gossip? Are you going to start slagging him off?
I'm not sure we can say that Eddie Hearn is in trouble because he's lost this bid. Because I think it's fair to Eddie Hearn that business is fairly booming. He had one of the biggest pay-per-view fights in UK history.
This is the Eddie Hearn channel here. The Eddie Hearn channel. But I'll put it.
We've got Joshua versus Klitschko around the corner. I'm not so sure that Eddie Hearn's going out of business anytime soon. Although I would admit it is disappointing that. And I may well do a video on it if I get time in my extremely busy schedule. But, it is disappointing that he was giving it lads about having this fight at Anfield and he's lost the purse bid, yeah.
I don't know how much you bid for purse bids like this, though, but, like, if you're saying you're going to have
you've got the bid, you've got the bids if you want to know, mate.
I know how much they were, like 1.2, 1.6. But, like, to me, like, if you're putting a show on in Anfield, like, you know, tens of thousands of tickets, seats. So it seems unlikely. It just seems unusual to me that he would be outbid by so much. When Frank bid with Huey, he was beaten by a bit, but like that's been, you know, he was being beat over outbid by 25% or 33.3%, whatever way you want to judge it. But so it's like he was quite a soundly outbid, but he is against the big money of Al Haymon. To be honest with you, it's not a fight I'm that interested in. I much prefer the fight that's coming with Gervonta Davis and Liam Walsh, which I think is quite a, like, I do think Davis is the favorite, but you know, Liam Walsh is a far superior fighter to me than Pedraza. Certainly the Pedraza we saw in that fight was really poor and played tactically very poor. So, you know, I think that's a great matchup of styles. You have kind of like a, you know, you have your Walsh, who's kind of like a classical boxer type, and Gervonta Davis, who's, I don't know, what would you call Gervonta Davis, boxer puncher?
I guess so, mate. Yeah, I guess you'd, it's kind of hard to describe him. Like, I think
I've really like seen... Is he like a David Haye type fighter? You know, is he a... You know, he's a weird one.
No, he's not like David.
Yeah. Yeah, not for, not if Floyd wants to be, stay alive in this promotion business. But I think that's a great matchup in styles. I think that's a, you know, a really good sign for BT if they're getting that fight. That's a top, I think that's a top fight. You know, that's, I didn't think Frank would make that. I thought he would stay away from Davis. But, you know, great fight. That's a, one of the best fights to look forward to now in the UK, coming after these good run of Eddie's ones. But yeah, looking forward to it. The Callum one, you know, the Andre Durrell, is it Andre Durrell or Anthony Durrell?
Anthony.
I actually haven't seen too much of him. So I, you know, we'll see what happens after, how long is it since he's had a decent fight, Callum?
Rocky Fielding, I guess, if that constitutes a decent fight.
Has he had a decent fight?
Rebras?
Rebras, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, he's had a few domestic-level fights, and now this is a jump to probably one of the weakest, you know, titles he could possibly hope to get his hands on. So, kind of typical Joe Gallagher kind of stuff, but we'll see what happens. I'm not... You know, I'm not particularly looking forward to it. God, Callum Smith, he is so miserable. He's so fucking miserable. Like, he's rivaled only in the misery by Liam Smith. They are the two most dour, fucking miserable bastards I have ever laid eyes on. You know.
He's not very charismatic, yeah. Do you have any thoughts, early thoughts, Iris, as to who you're going to be picking in those two fights, though?
I haven't seen enough Anthony Durrell to make a decision on that, but I would go with Gervonta Davis, but I think that if there's a style to try and beat Davis, it is Walsh, and I do give Liam Walsh a shot. I think it's kind of one of those, like, so I'd probably make Liam Walsh like a probably a 5-2 underdog.
Do you know what though? I think Liam Walsh is a bit chinny. I've seen him put down in fights possibly twice that I've actually been to. And he's just a bit sloppy. I'm not saying I've ever seen him in trouble or getting stopped, but I've seen him put down at a lower level. I remember seeing him get put down on the Haye Chisora undercard at West Ham by a journeyman. And I just wonder if a guy like Gervonta Davis is just going to blow him out of there, you know?
Yeah. Well, if he is chinny, then he's up against the wrong man. It'll be strange for Frank to put all that money in to get a guy over like that if he thought he was chinny. But maybe that explains why he hasn't been pushed up through the rankings so much. Frank has developed him. Was that at a lower weight, do you think? Is he at a higher weight now?
No, he's never been at a lower weight than this. He's actually been at a higher weight in the past, and he's kind of gone up and down. He almost got a world title sort of lightweight, actually, but there was a car incident, so he didn't take it. But, yeah, I feel for Liam Watts, because I've been talking about Liam Watts on this channel for 3 or 4 years, saying... he's a great fighter. He can win a world championship. And I've really, really wanted to see him move up in levels. But it seems he's had British opponent, British opponent, British opponent, British opponent. And now he's up against like a truly class act. And I know Gervonta Davis is quite untested, but he looks the real deal, doesn't he? And it's kind of, you just wonder if Ryan Watts maybe could have been handled differently, in my opinion.
Yeah, like if he is chinny, like then it's an easy win for Javonta Davis. But if it's not, I still think I give him about, like if he's not so chinny, I think he's got a live chance. I think he's a live dog.
Yeah, I mean stylistically he is, but I think that the power to chin ratio doesn't bode well for him in this particular.
Yeah. I've only seen him I haven't seen that much of Walsh. I've seen him on and off because I used to have Box Nation, and before I found the world of streaming, I wasn't able to see a lot of his fights. So I think he's I like his style. I like Ron Walsh's style, but I think that, you know, I would kind of class it like the same kind of underdog was Fury was with Klitschko. You know, that kind of 3-4-1 underdog, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Is there a price yet for him? Is there a price?
I will try and look that up as we're talking, actually. Let me just have a look. I'll just pull up odds check and now. Well, it was May the 6th, wasn't it?
I don't know. I'm just on odds checker now myself.
So here we go.
It's 3-1 underdog. Javonta Davis 1-4, Liam Wallace 3-1. It's about. I nearly sound like a proper bookmaker there. I got it kind of on spot on. Usually my odds are way out. But yeah, 3-1 you get for Walsh. I think that's about right.
I must admit, I don't think I would be rushing to bat Liam Walsh at 3-1 despite the home advantage.
No, but I think, yeah, if his chin is bad, I don't think it's a good price. But if his chin is decent, I think that's about right.
Yeah. All right, Paul, what's your take on the Callum Smith-Durrell fight? Well, what's your take on the fight itself and on Hearn losing the purse bid?
I'm surprised Hearn lost the purse bid, to be honest. I haven't seen that much of Durrell. It's Anthony Durrell, isn't it? I haven't seen that much of Anthony Durrell, yeah. But I don't think Callum Smith has looked particularly good in recent fights. I think he's made a meal of opponents that he should have been. If he's the goods, he should have been really just dealing with quite handily. I mean, it's entirely possible that he's one of these fighters that struggles to get up for lesser opponents. He seemed to go into almost sparring sort of mode in some of these fights. But I don't know. I'm dubious as to whether he's, you know, all he's sort of being touted as being. I'm not so sure about him. But I mean, Eddie Hearn did seem to be sort of like really sort of pushing him as a fighter. So you would have thought that he would have made a decent. I mean, with the, I don't know how these purse bids work. Do they just both bid, and then whoever's bid is the highest?
Yeah, seal bids. So you don't know how much the other person is bidding, and if it goes to purse bids, anyone can bid. So if it's Frank Warren versus Eddie Hearn, Mick Hennessy could pop up with a bid. So often they try and avoid purse bids to keep control. But yeah, at a purse bid, anyone can bid, and it's completely sealed.
Yeah, so I mean, he's obviously bid that just thinking nobody's going to bid any higher, isn't he? You know, they've obviously surprised him with a 1.6. I mean, that is quite a high amount because, I mean, neither of them are. I mean, Durrell as a name is probably reasonably well known, I suppose, in the States, but. Callum Smith wouldn't be known too much, I wouldn't imagine. I don't really have an instinct as to who will win that fight. I'd have to have a look at Anthony Durrell. I haven't seen that much of him. But I'm excited for you, the fight. Javonta Davis, Liam Walsh. I really like that fight. I think it's a great fight. I like Liam Walsh. I think he's really good. I don't know if he's chinny. He gets caught a lot. I think it was Joe Murray.
Yes.
I think he might have fought Joe Murray twice. I'm not sure.
That's correct. Yeah.
He did, yeah. In one of those fights, Joe Murray seemed to be catching him quite a lot. And I don't think Joe Murray's that great. But when he turns it on, he seems to go asleep at times. But I think for a fight like this, he'd be really up for this. And I'm not so sure he's chinny. I mean, he's never been knocked out or anything, has he? He's
never been knocked out. I've just seen him dropped by like a low level of fighter.
Yeah, I mean, I. What do we mean when we say chinny? I mean, I think anybody can get dropped. Literally anybody who can be caught right can just be timed or whatever and dropped. I don't think that necessarily means you're chinny. What I think of as chinny is someone like Amir Khan that when they get dropped, they just can't recover. They chicken dance all around the place or they just don't get up at all. That's what I think of as chinny. Sorry to any Amir Khan fans, but that's what
I think. You make a fair point. Like, I consider Tyson Fury to have a very good chin, for example, because he's been hurt and got up and worked it off and got stoppage wins after being hurt. So, no, you make a fair point, actually. So, I concede that you're right and I'm wrong there. But just against such a thunderous puncher as Gervonta Davis, I just fear for Liam Walsh in this one, actually.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it does depend whether he can take Davis's power. I mean, the thing is, he hasn't fought anybody anywhere near as good as Davis. But then again, Davis had never fought anybody anywhere. He'd fought nobody's journeyman and nobody's until the Pedraza fight. And Pedraza looked terrible that night. I agree with Tom. I think with Irish, Liam Walsh is way better than Pedraza. I think he's way better than Pedraza. Liam Walsh is a really decent boxer. He puts his punches together really well. He's really accurate with his punches as well. I like him. I think he's live, more than live. I think he's... I'm not sure where I'll pick him. I'd have to research a bit more closer to the fight, but... I don't think it's as cut and dry, and I think the fact that it's over here will be a big thing for Walsh. You know, Davis didn't seem to be fazed at all by the big occasion and the world title shot. He seemed very, very relaxed, but I suppose that could have been home turf. You know, surrounded by all the TMT fighters and everything, that's an environment in which somebody is going to be comfortable. How comfortable? Where is this? Where do you know where?
Copper box,
right? Yeah, I mean, how comfortable will he be coming over here and walking into a bit of a lion's den? Who knows? Who knows?
What else is on that bill?
My understanding, Tom, is that the copper box bill that was originally put out, which included the likes of Bradley Skeet, is going to be done on a different date. And there's going to be a new bill on the undercard for this one. So that could be incorrect, but my understanding is that at present, this is a standalone fight. Floyd Mayweather was talking about putting Ashley Fairfane on the undercard because it's a co-promotion. And I believe the Bradley Skeet card will be later on that month, potentially with Mitchell Smith as well, if my memory recalls.
Yeah, I'm just looking at Jed. There's only one. That's the only fight on in Cop Box. I might go to that if it's on. I wonder what the tickets will be like for that.
Yeah.
What price will the tickets be like for a fight like that?
You'll be able to get entry-level tickets for 40 quid, mate, I'm sure.
Let's have a look at that. Because I can imagine, like, that's a great headline. To me, that's a real good quality world title fight. So, and you know, a fighter like Gervonta Davis might be the goods, might be a chance to see somebody like him live.
Absolutely. Yeah, it could be good. And that, I'm not sure what Liam Walsh's fan base is like, actually.
There's seven in it. He's got seven people in his fan base.
He's got seven. Yeah. It was really, really, really disappointing. Javonte Davis comes over and the fight is fought at a half-empty copper box. But the copper box is the kind of arena where, like, if they did absolutely sell it out and put a massive event in there, you know, it could be like a real good place to watch boxing, I think.
Yeah, have you been there before?
I have been there before, not to watch boxing, though.
Okay, grand, yeah. So, no, it's quite close to where I live as well, so I think I'll probably go to that.
Yeah. It's quite easy. Yeah, maybe I'll go along with you, Tom. Maybe we'll do that. But yeah, no, that sounds good. Okay, let's move it on because we're flagging behind in terms of stuff we've got to cover. So I'm just having a look to see what the other major stories are. We got the Dillian White versus Bryant Jennings beef. We've got the O'Hara Davis versus Floyd Mayweather beef. We've got Billy Joe Saunders saying that he's going to announce his next fight after Golovkin Jacobs, which has led to speculation it's going to be Golovkin. Huey versus Joseph Parker, now confirmed for May 6th in Auckland. And Manny Pacquiao versus Khan in the UAE falling through. So, Iris, any of those that you particularly want to get your teeth stuck into?
Only the let me think, the Khan Pacquiao one, I put money on, and it's one of these before the end of the year type bets to get the better price, and the fucking thing has been pulled, so my money is sitting there stuck in escrow for the next 9 months, 10 months, so that's annoying. One thing, when I was at the Boy Jones Jr. fight the other night, Mitchell Smith was there, and he was looking, I thought, quite fat. I don't know.
He always does, Tom. Between fights, the guy always blows up. He doesn't seem to have any control of his weight.
Yeah, like, I'm not going to say he was, like, chubby or anything, but he didn't look like he was close to making weight. So, you know, I was, you know, I thought he was turning over a new leaf with Adam Booth. So we'll see. If that George Jupp fight has been cancelled, maybe it's for reasons to do with not being professional. Yeah, so the other ones, I don't think I have anything to say in any of the rest of them, to be honest. No, pass.
Okay. Let's go over to yourself, Paul. Before we go on to looking ahead at next week's boxing, what about this Billy Joe Saunders news, Paul? Looks like it could well be Golovkin. Do you think that fight's actually going to happen?
I think it might. I think it might, you know. I mean, this is obviously, I mean, he said he's going to announce on March 18th, which just happens to be the same day of the Golovkin fight. I mean, that's obviously, whether, you know, he probably won't announce on that day. That's just to get everybody to think it's Golovkin again. That's all that is. You know, like, he's already done that once in an interview, hasn't he? I'll be announcing next week it's a world champion and I'm going to his, it's the man and I'm going to his backyard or whatever. But I think it might happen. I think Adam Booth's a good motivator, you know, and I think he might, you know, it's not entirely impossible he's got into Billy Joe's head and sort of like said, we can get you ready for this and, you know, get you a decent payday. And I think Billy Joe's all about the money, isn't he? I mean, that's, in the middleweight division, the only person that he's going to get that sort of money is by fighting Golovkin. From the other point of view, Golovkin's made it very, very clear that he wants to unify, that he wants all the belts. He's not a big middleweight, and so I can understand his reluctance to go up to super middleweight. I don't think, I mean, can you imagine? I mean, I think his power would carry up probably because, you know, there's all the sort of like sparring stuff with him hurting big guys, big. Super middleweights and even light heavyweights in sparring. So I think his power probably would carry up, but he's not a big guy, is he? I don't think he's a big middleweight.
He's a small middleweight, mate. Very small middleweight.
Yeah, so, I mean, I can see that making sense from both their perspectives. Billy Joe is somebody that I don't think is a... He's not a sort of like a Floyd, is he, that just... is going to live the lifestyle and loves the lifestyle and whatnot. I see him as another sort of like Bellew or Tyson Fury that don't particularly like the fight game, don't particularly like having to make weight and whatnot, really want to just make as much money as they can and get out. And that seems like the easiest way to do it for me.
Yeah. No, I completely hear you. Okay, what about the other stuff, Paul? Huey Fury versus Joseph Parker finally confirmed. Good news.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely good news. Yeah. I mean, when is it confirmed for again?
May 6th.
Right. So, when's the ring supposed to be?
Early May.
that's my only worry. I mean, obviously, you'd have to think that the hearing probably wouldn't be before the fight. They're not going to have some hearing like days before a big fight. They'll
have to go out to New Zealand 2 weeks before, won't they, for the jet lag? Because it's like a 13-hour gap.
Yeah, exactly. So he's not going to be in the country for any early May, you know, certainly not before the fight. So, yeah, that's not going to get in the way of it. So, yeah, obviously the fight will happen. It'd be shame if he won it and then got stripped, wouldn't it? I mean, I can see him beating Parker, to be honest. I really can. I've said it for a while. I really like Huey Fury. I can see him winning that fight. So yeah, great news. What was the other? You read out a few things there, Tom.
I also put down Manny Pacquiao versus Conn in the UAE falling through. Dillian White and Bryant Jennings having a bit of a beef, and Ahura Davis versus Floyd Mayweather in a big argument.
Gossip. Did you say Dillian White had a beef with someone?
Unbelievable, isn't it? Unbelievable. Yeah. He was in an empty room, but he still managed to get in a beef with Brian Jennings.
I don't know what's wrong with the world. There's a lot of people out there have got problems with Dillian White, and it's about time they fucking left Dillian alone.
Yeah, he's so mild-mannered, isn't he? That's the thing.
Yeah. It's because everyone's always talking rubbish when they're around him, I think. And he doesn't appreciate it. But I like Dillian White. Dillian White is not a fan of the channel. Actively not a fan of his channel, but I'm a fan of Dillian White.
fan of the channel?
But no, he's not a fan. No.
Oh, yeah.
There you go.
Well, yeah. Tell him if Dillian's not a fan of the channel, then I'll sort him out. And you tweet me, Dillian, and I'll meet you in a car park and I'll fucking straighten you out.
Yeah, we're calling him out here, right here and now.
Dillian.
You've just given away your near enough your home address with the fact you live next to the copper box. And there's a photo of you on the screen, Tom, so I'd be very, very careful.
It's London is a big place. You could be 5 miles in the copper box and there could be 4 million of you.
Dillian, if you're watching, I will sell Irish Tom's personal contact details to you for, about a fiver. I'm kidding.
I'll give you £5 and twopence.
I jet.
Not to sell them.
There we go.
You're jet.
I said I jest. No. Sadly, I'm not jest.
I know.
I'm not jet. My knowledge.
Jess. That's our new name from Jess. Yes. I was being sarcastic, but Jess is the new name.
Yes. Just Jess. Very good. Okay, let's move on to discussing the boxing for the next 2 weeks. And if you're watching live and you've just joined us, unfortunately not doing a podcast next week, so we're getting the next 2 weeks worth of boxing picks out today. But I think even though it's 2 weeks, the biggest fight by far is Golovkin versus Danny Jacobs. And do you know what? It's a fight that I've never been excited for because Jacobs is very, very vulnerable. And against a guy like Golovkin, I think that vulnerability is going to put him in a very, very dangerous place. But nevertheless, it's Golovkin taking on, one of the top three middleweights in the world, let's say. So it's a good fight when you've got the number one and some people would say the number two going at it against each other. So let's start with yourself, Paul. How do you see that fight going?
Yeah, well, I'm always excited for a Triple G fight. I'm a massive Triple G fan. He's certainly in my top three favorite fighters in boxing at the minute. I love his style. I love the way he fights. I think there's a lot more to his game than people think. He's not just a puncher, which is what people seem to view him as. I think this fight is. I mean, I agree with you. I think Jacobs is very vulnerable, but also though, Jacobs can bang, and Golovkin tends to use his jab and kind of like break down sort of like gradually when he respects the guy's power. And I think he kind of really has to respect Jacobs' power. Jacobs clearly has got power. I can see him just breaking him down in about five or six rounds with the jab. Similarly to the, I know Jacobs is a bit taller than Lemieux, but he's got that sort of high guard, sort of ducking down, sort of similar kind of style. Not the same, but similar kind of style. I can see him just jabbing the head off him for about five or six rounds, and then stopping him. I don't see Jacobs winning. Not at all. I think Golovkin is by far the best in that division. I think he's fucking miles above anybody in that division. What I am looking forward to now, though, is all the sort of like naysayers that were like, oh, he's fought nobody despite about six of his last sort of like eight opponents being top 10 middleweights at the time of the fight. Despite that, they're all like, he's never fought anybody. Why doesn't he fight Jacobs? I'd be interested to see what the sort of like reason to slag him off after that will be, you know. Look, I am looking forward to the fight. I don't think it's going to be hugely competitive, but who knows, it might be. Jacob's got a puncher's chance. I think that's about it.
Definitely. If you had to put your money where your mouth is, are you going early stoppage?
Yeah, early to mid, I think. Early to midpoint.
Cool. Sounds good. Iris, let's bring you in on that one, mate.
Yeah, well, I'm a big GGG fan, like Paul, big time. He's one of my favourite fighters, probably my favourite fighter at the moment to watch. I just love his style. And I've been rewatching some GGG fights over the last couple of weeks, get myself in the mood. I watched the Willie Monroe Jr. fight. I don't know if anybody's watched that in a while. But in that fight, GGG just fought so recklessly. He tasted your man's power and then just didn't give a damn. Like, if you want to see, people say that Kell Brook exposed GGG. Well, if you're going to say that, you got to actually say Willie Jr. exposed him a hell of a lot more, because he caught him a lot. And I think that, you know, when he tastes a guy's power and he thinks that they're not able to hurt him, he just basically fights in a fan-friendly style. I expect him. I've watched the Lemieux fight since, and you know Lemieux had a punch, so he just completely schooled him at boxing. Now I forgot how much he schooled him. I watched it again, so I predict that it'll start off like the Lemieux fight, but I think Lemieux showed some good heart in there and he took some good shots. But I kind of expect that even if GGG, you know, just jabs and throws an occasional left hook or straight right or whatever, I think he might even still knock out Danny Jacobs early, because, you know, Sergio Mora is able to knock you. Is it Sergio Mora, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, if he's able to knock him down, like, you know, even GGG kind of half catching him will probably do the same thing. So I don't think this is a competitive fight at all. You can get, I think, 4-11 on a GGG KO. I think that's the price I got him at. Well, I think that's good value. You know, it's crazy to say that you've got like one versus, say, number two or number three or probably number four in the division, you know, and it's, you know, such a lopsided fight. That just shows the combination of the strength of GGG and the weakness of that division.
Definitely. No, I completely agree. If he goes through Jacobs and then fights Saunders next, that is complete domination of a definitely. Tom, let's stick with you for the Irish angle, mate. Jamie Conlon fighting this week, Mick Conlon fighting next week. Those two in action.
Yeah, but I think neither of them are fighting anybody of note. So Jamie Conlon is fighting, what's the guy? I checked up the guy a few weeks ago. I forget his name, but like, I think he's got a reasonably poor record. So Jimmy, he's always in a good fight, but you know, if he's in a good fight against all these low level guys, he'll never go anywhere. But and Mick Conlon, yeah. So that's on Paddy's Day, is that right? That's on the Friday in MSG.
Yeah.
And then on Saturday you've got GGG in MSG, is it? Or is it the Brooklyn Center?
That's right. Yeah. There was that big controversy with Eddie Hearn and Katie Taylor on the bill apparently, and kicked off massively.
What do you mean? Say again?
Well, apparently Eddie Hearn had Katie Taylor on the Golovkin undercard. Mick Conlon's promoter. Is that...
Oh, Bob Arum.
Mick Conlon kicked off and threatened Sue for putting another Irish gold medalist on at the same time.
Threatened Sue for what? How did he sue for that?
Eddie Hearn did say that, didn't he, in the...
He's already been sarcastic, let's say.
I must admit, I did think, like, when I saw it, sue for what? Yeah, but apparently it caused a huge, huge grief, and Top Rank did not want Katie Taylor competing with Conlon.
Yeah, no, it would be bad for the Irish crowd. Like, we might go to Katie Taylor. But Mick Conlon is, I'll be excited to follow his career now. I think finally we've got a real top level amateur prospect out of Ireland, first time in a good while.
Definitely. The other boxing action, Tom, at the minute, I guess one of the big fights that could stylistically turn into a very, very good fight this week is Lemieux versus Curtis Stevens. I'm also quite looking forward to Mansour versus Kaufman and Dennis Kalin versus Isaac Lowe. Are any of those ones that you're going to be keeping your eyes out for?
Yeah, I'll probably check them out, but they're all this weekend, or is it this week and next weekend?
This week and next weekend, mate.
Yeah. So there, you know, there's
Stevens is this weekend. The week following is Mansour, Kaufman, and Kalin Lowe.
Yeah, I'll be watching. We're watching the Stevens, definitely the Stevens and the Lemieux one. I think that's got all. That's got a very fan-friendly fight. I probably expect Lemieux to win that. I know we talked about this before. People were saying that they think Stevens is shot. So I don't have any bets on now this weekend. Not till the GGG fight. I've been looking around. Haven't seen anything that seems interesting. But still licking the wounds after that shit show of a weekend. I'm lucky I was drunk when it happened.
Yeah. It's a hard one to come back from that, isn't it? But we're all in the same boat, I think, Tom.
I'm so sick. Yeah. So since we've done the podcast, it's been like, I've had, that's like up there with the Eggington classic. The Gavin Eggington.
Yeah.
Fuck me, Andy.
I never realised quite how many fights I get wrong till I started doing this YouTube channel.
Yeah, me too. And especially ones where I'm so book sure it's going to go one way and you make a total idiot out of yourself.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, though, I'm pretty delighted that I got the Thurman Garcia one right, because every instinct in my body was telling me to pick Garcia, but I resisted and went Keith Thurman. So that's the second time I've had that heart versus head conundrum. Both times I've gone with my head, and both times my head has been correct. So I think that's a formula I'm going to have to follow more, I'm afraid.
Did you follow your head and you ignored your heart? You didn't back Tony Bellew.
Tony Bellew wasn't a head or a heart one, but
he wasn't even an arse one.
It was honest to God, I would have given any odds on Tony Bellew to win that fight. But there you go. Strange things happen in the sport.
Mikey says in the chat, Lemieux wins, Mansour wins, and Lowe wins. I'm not sure about Amir Mansour, you know. I think he had the... He's an old guy now, and I think he had the will beaten out of him a bit by Brazil, and he's been inactive since. Like, you know, I'm not 100% sure what Amir Mansour is going to turn up, although I do agree if the proper Amir Mansour turns out, he's going to win. Paul, Lemieux-Stevens, that's a tough fight. I kind of side with Lemieux just on the basis that I think Stevens is more of a sort of fighter. But what's your take on that one, Paul?
Yeah, I mean, it's a decent fight. It will be a fan friendly fight. I mean, just based on the styles and stuff. I'd pick Lemieux to win that, regardless of whether Stevens is shot or not. Stevens, he didn't look good in his last couple of fights. De La Rosa was his last fight, and he didn't look good in that. He laboured to a UD, I think. It was a split decision, I'm not sure. I think Lemieux is just... I don't think he's got a lot of punch resistance, Curtis Stevens, anymore. I mean, it's the battle of the Triple G victims, isn't it? You know, like, it's kind of like who's had the most shit beat out of them by Triple G, you know, and it's probably Curtis Stevens. I think you give Curtis Stevens a hell of a hiding in that fight. I think Lemieux will win, but it's a decent fight. I'll definitely watch it.
Yeah, it's one that could turn into a bit of a scrap. And I think stylistically, Stevens has a good style to beat Lemieux. But I just think Lemieux's a bit fresher. I think Stevens has got a lot of miles on the clock. What about Mansour Kaufman or Kalen Lowe? Are those ones that you've seen the guys before, Paul?
I've seen them before, but I'm not massively excited for it. Mansour is kind of like getting on a bit, isn't he? I don't know if he's maybe just shot. Lowe, I'm not sure if I've seen him or not.
He's Tyson Fury's cousin.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Is he good?
I think he's very good, but I also think Dennis Kalen is very good. I watched him beat Ryan Walsh, and he did a really good job then. He's a very big guy as well, I think.
Okay. Oh, I'll have a look at that one then.
I'm a fan. Definitely. Okay. Is Gary Russell Jr. is fighting as well? We kind of need Jet here because he's got the great expertise, but I'll just pull it up on BoxRec. So Gary Russell Jr. is fighting a guy called Oscar Escandon, who's 25-2. And he is 5'1", according to... have either of you guys heard of Oscar Escandon?
No.
Nope.
Gary Russell Jr. is small enough. BoxRec's got him at 5'4". You can't really pay any attention to the BoxRec heights and stuff because they're always quite clearly wrong. But no, 5'1" is he? Oscar Escandon. I've got to be honest, I've never ever heard of him.
Yeah, no, true. I'm sure Jet's been following him since the white collar scene.
Lads, do you remember I was saying last week or the week before about what kind of a bad run this could have been for Eddie Hearn? Bellew gets knocked out.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Do you remember that one? But like, fucking Eddie Hearn, he's going to pull us out of the bag. I've switched back to AJ now. I think AJ's probably got the youth. After seeing like David Haye being out for and coming back and not looking the same, I think we've got to, you know, that's got to be a big factor in this Klitschko fight. So I think I'm going to go and stick with my initial read and go AJ all the way.
Yeah, what? Tom, you know, we were talking about what disaster it could be for Eddie Hearn. What a success it could also be for Eddie Hearn, I guess, if all of those results go his way. You know, if if Crawler wins. One thing Eddie Hearn has done very well recently is his timing of fights. You know, Bellew Haye was timed perfectly for Bellew. Eddington Malinaji was timed perfectly for Eddington. Who's the other one? Ahura Davies, Derry Matthews was timed perfectly for Ahura Davies. You know, all of Hearn's fighters would have probably lost those fights a year ago, but Eddie Hearn has made those fights at exactly the right time. And you know, if the same thing is true with Crawler Linares and Joshua Klitschko, then Eddie Hearn, he's going to be on quite some run, isn't he?
I can't.
He is. I can't.
See I don't remember beating Linares. Like,
I was just going to say the same thing, Paul.
But I do think AJ will beat Klitschko. I mean, I think Klitschko looked very tentative in the Tyson Fury fight. I think part of that was his age. I think part of it was Tyson's awkwardness. But part of it was he didn't know what Tyson was going to do. And that made him, made him not want to throw, apart from the last couple of rounds he started to throw. I think he is going to know what's coming back at him. And I think, I just think that period out, his age, Joshua's just momentum, his youth, his power. I think Joshua will probably emerge as the top heavyweight in the country in the next year. In the world, sorry.
You were going for Klitschko a few weeks ago.
When the fight was first announced, I thought Klitschko, yeah, just off the top of my head. But the more I think about it, I just think this... I mean, what's it going to be? It's going to be like 18 months, nearly 2 years by the time the fight happens that Klitschko will have been out of the ring. 18 months, is it?
Yeah, November.
That's a long time for a man of his age.
It is.
And obviously Joshua's been fighting regularly. He's young. He's clearly very confident. I just think it's... Yeah, I have. My opinion's changed. I do think Joshua's going to do it.
I think it's very unlikely I'll be changing that pick. I'm picking Klitschko. But what I would say is, you guys know I've always been a skeptic of Joshua. But... recently, I've watched a few heavyweight fights, you know. You watched Haye Bellew the other day. You watched Wilder, Wilder versus Washington the other day. And you did just think, like, Joshua was a bit of a level above this, you know. Could you see that? I know it's only Tony Bellew, but could you see Haye going 11 rounds on one leg with Joshua? Or... you know, could you see Bellew eating those punches he ate from Haye against Joshua? And, you know, could you see Joshua giving up the first three rounds against Washington like Wilder did? You know, he is very close to the top of the division.
But the thing is, though, is that, like, the reason why Bellew was able to take his punches is because Haye's speed was gone. And he probably wasn't throwing 100% because of his injury.
The injury only happened in the sixth round. He didn't look injured to me in the early rounds, and he did catch Tony Pellew.
He did. Well, I thought his speed was very diminished. Oh, and the other thing, Paul, is like, I don't know if he's throwing 100%, you know, or if he can throw 100%. If he was carrying this injury.
Yeah, he was carrying the injury. I just think he's got old. I just think the shoulder... you know, from before, I think he looked slow, and he just couldn't find his range. He just, everything he was throwing was either short or was so slow that it was missing by a fucking mile.
Yeah, no, I think, whatever. I think, but if you ask me, if I have picked Joshua and Wilder, I pick Wilder against Joshua.
No.
I think Wilder will knock Joshua out.
No, I picked Joshua against Wilder. I think Wilder looked awful against Washington.
Yeah, I'm one of these converts now. I would definitely pick Joshua over Wilder. Wilder's, his accuracy is terrible. And
yeah, but he only has to land once.
Yeah, but it's he only has to land once. It's the same the other way around. And Joshua has superior timing to Wilder. Joshua's timing and ability to counterpunch is actually one of his best attributes. And the way Wilder comes in, swinging like a lunatic, I just think Joshua catches him. You know, I think Joshua waits,
sees a gap like that, and Wilder gives a gap like that in every fight almost immediately. And I think Joshua just sees opportunities like that, and he's very, very good.
I think Wilder will. I do think Joshua is a better fighter, but I think Wilder will knock him out, because I think if you know, Joshua doesn't hit as hard as Wilder, and Wilder will test that chin. And Wilder's very athletic and he's very fast. AJ's been in with no one fast.
The only thing that would make me doubt it would be Wilder's chin. Wilder seems to have a decent chin.
And he has a jab if he uses it.
Wilder's got a good jab if he uses it, yeah. You know what, Paul? It's funny you say that, actually, because Wilder is known as having one of the worst chins in the sport because of the amount of times he's been hurt in the amateurs and hurt by journeymen. But I've got to say, like, I know he's not been in with, like, a top class puncher, but Wilder recently has clearly shown that his chin isn't quite as glassy as people make out. I think his biggest issue is the fact that he does the windmilling thing. Yeah, the biggest issue. And I think that's going to be his Achilles heel.
I think the windmilling thing, I think that his balance, he's got awful balance. I think, and also that thing, I've heard you mention it in videos before, where he jumps back with his arms in the air, as if he's playing volleyball.
Look, lads.
Bit of speed and power, when he does that, are just going to just step in and they're going to just spark him. I really do. I think as soon as he is in with somebody with a bit of speed and power, I think it'll be all over for him, personally.
I just think I think that you guys are kind of, well, the windmilling thing is something he does after he has the guy completely in bits and he's sparking. And we know that AJ didn't respond.
He done that in the Washington fight before we even had him hurt or anything. He was
no, he didn't, Paul. He didn't.
He did.
I don't know. I didn't see it. I saw it afterwards.
Washington wasn't really that badly hurt, even when the fight was stopped.
He was.
The other thing about Wilder is he's only good if he's like on the front foot, able to throw his power shots. If someone throws, even when Gerald Washington was throwing a jab that was missing, Wilder takes a huge step back. He's unable to throw his power punches on the back foot. He's unable to sort of move and throw his power punches. He's a guy who needs to be front foot heavy. And I think against a taller guy like Gerald Washington or against Anthony Joshua, he'd actually struggle.
Is that not exactly what he did when he fought your man Romain Stavern? Did he not fight on his back foot and still hurt him?
It is. He did fight on the back foot against Romain Stavern, and that was his best performance. But against a tall guy... Pardon?
He did knock him down as well.
He did knock him down. I don't think he knocked him down.
Really knocked him down, but he did knock him down.
They both fell down. I don't think that was a knockdown.
There's some hardcore Wilder hate going on here tonight, Paul. Go back and watch that.
No, I agree with Paul. I don't think it was a knockdown, actually.
Come on, lads. Come on.
But you know what?
Maybe I'm wrong.
Wilder's a good fighter, but essentially he's a guy who's a front foot athlete who relies on power and has limited technique. And I think a guy like Anthony Joshua, who's also a front foot guy, who's also a big guy, who's also got power, but for me has far superior timing and technique. Don't get me wrong, it's a 60-40 fight in Joshua's favour. Wilder's got immense power, big size, and if Wilder hits Joshua on the chin, Joshua's going. But who do I back to land first? I actually think Joshua's got the superior way of setting up his punches and the superior accuracy and timing. So I side with Joshua, I would do.
Yeah,
but it's not a thing about who lands first, because I think Wilder will be able to weather a storm, and I think Wilder's speed is just as good as Joshua's.
I don't see Wilder weathering a Joshua storm, to be honest.
I think he will. Like,
I don't think anybody will weather a storm from a real big puncher in, and all of those guys are big punchers at the top level. I don't think anybody's going to weather a proper storm from Joshua where he's catching him clean. I don't think anybody would.
Did Dominic Brazil not do it for 7 or 8 rounds?
Yeah, but he wasn't.
Did Dillian White not do it? You know, I think that people look. I think that we're looking at Joshua and we're forgetting who the fuck he's fought. Like, I think that he is very good, but you know, he's going to be going up against. I think if Klitschko is able to establish his jab, or if Klitschko is able to land with a power punch, he'll probably win that fight. He'll probably knock Joshua out.
I mean, the thing is, if Joshua beats Klitschko, after that fight, we'll be in a situation where Joshua will have been in with a better class of opponent after 18, 19 fights or whatever it is, than Wilder will have in nearly 40. So,
yeah.
I think it's ironic that you're questioning his level of opponent he's been in. He hasn't been in with anybody, and he's certainly not a top 10, but Wilder hasn't either.
No, I just mean that people, like, remember, we're in the Joshua bubble over here living in the UK, that, you know, that we forget that, you know, Joshua is level, that, you know, he hasn't been in with anybody with speed. Who's the best? He hasn't been in with anybody with speed, you know. So, and certainly not somebody with speed who can punch. You know, so I think that, like, you know, we'll see how Joshua reacts to it. Now, whether Klitschko can carry that speed still at his age is a big thing, or carry the power. We just saw David Haye fall on his arse, you know. All I'm saying is that I'm afraid that Eddie Hearn is going to clean up. He's going to win all these, and then Cal Brook will fucking win. Here, is Cal Brook fight even been announced yet?
No.
It hasn't?
No, it hasn't, no.
So I'm still a bit sceptical about that, lads.
May?
Huh?
Last weekend of May at Bremer Lane.
But that hasn't been confirmed. And is it something like that Sheffield United might have a playoff game or something there?
June the 3rd at the O2 as a reserve.
I think that's why they haven't announced it yet, Eddie Hearn said. But somebody in the chat was saying that earlier as well, that they were sceptical of this Brook-Spence fight. I mean, I hope that doesn't get cancelled, because that's for me, that's the best fight in the 147 division by a mile.
Well, it's the best one at the moment, you know, considering that Danny and Thing just fought. It's one of the best.
I think it's a better fight than Thurman Garcia.
No, I mean, like, say Thurman versus Spence, or Thurman versus Brook, or Pacquiao. You know, so there's quite a few good ones, but it's definitely one of the top ones. But so I'm kind of skeptical whether that fight's going to happen or not. Sometimes people have done these, purse bids, and then they don't actually follow through, and, you know, somebody vacates. So I'm not. I wouldn't be surprised if it doesn't go through. Not hating on Cal Ratton, but I wouldn't be surprised if Eddie Hearn managed just convince him maybe to move up. The other thing is, after watching David Haye struggle there, I think that, you know, that underlines how difficult that fight is going to be for Cal Brook, cutting that weight after taking a beating at a higher division. I think that, you know, Spence, to me, is the man to beat there.
Yeah, I that is a very hard fight to call. That it's a great, great fight. It's so competitive. At the minute, I'm siding with Spence, but that is one that I do reserve the right to change the opinion on, definitely. But yeah, there we go, guys. Anything else before we call it a night?
Can't think of anything.
Nothing from me.
Good stuff. Right. Well, that brings us to the close for this week's podcast, guys. Thanks very much to everyone who's watched us. Just to reiterate one last time, no podcast next Wednesday, which is Wednesday the 15th, but we'll be back as per normal Wednesday the 22nd. So stay tuned. If you've enjoyed the show and watched live, please do take the time to hit the thumbs up button, which massively helps with the visibility. Also, we still get about 50% of the views from people who aren't actually subscribers. So do take the time to subscribe so you can check out all my other stuff if you're on the channel. Thanks to all the panel. Thanks to Jet, who was on earlier for an hour or so. You can check out his channel, which is Boxing Discussions. Thanks, as always, to Paul and to Iris Tom, their time. And thanks to everyone in the chat. But yeah,
that's us for tonight. And yeah, have a good evening, guys, and we will catch up very soon, I'm sure.
All right, guys. Ciao.